few words about Churchill Club. Since 1985, we serve as one of the world's premier independent stages for conversations about technology and business innovation. Our passion is to inspire and fortify people everywhere who desire to contribute to innovation, economic growth, and societal benefit, and to be better leaders, collaborators, and citizens. In the programs that we create for you, we generally look for what's new, next, not widely discussed, so that we can build on insights that are out there rather than repeating them. We thank Skadden, especially Ken King, for opening their doors to us in this incredible conference center space. I hope you caught the full rainbow out there right now. Great place for a visionary conversation. So let's now, without further comments, get started with our conversation.
Thank you, and a big round of applause and a big thank you to Karen and the today. I just have a few opening remarks here. You know, Reid Hoffman once said, the real secret of Silicon Valley is that it's truly all about the people. And I would actually take it to the next level and say that it's all about the people who truly act as leaders. And those leaders choosing to lead by example. It's not about what you say, it's truly what you do. And that's what makes Silicon Valley so great, is we don't just talk about innovation. We truly innovate. So when we talk about the elitism, the sexism, the discrimination allegations plaguing Silicon Valley, let's do as we innovate. Let's let our actions speak louder than words. And that's what we really hope you walk away with today. Actions that will democratize innovation for all who come here to this birthplace of some of the most innovative technologies, just true innovation that you don't see anywhere else in this world. And actions that allow everyone to really innovate in an environment where everyone can thrive, no matter their race, their religion, their gender, or their sex. Okay, so please welcome our speakers. Of course, right here we have Leslie and Anne, and of course, Nick will be joining us in just a few moments. Let's start with Anne. I want to begin with you. In what way do you think that Silicon Valley is truly in a moral and ethical crisis, if at all?
I would say it's more in a moral and ethical awakening. I think people are starting to appreciate moral judgment, ethical leadership, the implications, the way that they influence how business is done, not just what the innovation is, but how the innovation is handled. And I think it has a lot to do to some degree with sort of the civic maturity of Silicon Valley. The fact that it's still a relatively young community in terms of how long it's been identified as its own entity, referred to as Silicon Valley since sometime in the 70s. And so I guess that puts us kind of in our mid-40s. And so you see it both on the philanthropic side. You know, people talk about, well, gee, how come these folks that have all this wealth, why aren't they better at giving it away? Why don't they support more of the needs in the community? Well, they're getting there, and they're trying. They're also innovating in the way that they do that. So I think it's both a combination of the fact that the community itself is still evolving and emerging, and then also the fact that we have a number of people in leadership positions who are relatively young. And moral judgment is something like anything. How many people in the room are parents? So have you ever been in the parent-teacher conference and they tell you that your child's not doing something because it's developmental, which is a nice way of saying, like, the other kids are doing it, but your child's not doing it yet because they just haven't gotten there. And they want you to not freak out about it because eventually your child will get there, because we all always do. And you have to learn one set of things that are foundational before you can, you know, move on to learn the next. Well, moral judgment's the same way. So we actually start when we're very young with very simple ways of thinking about things. I want to get what I want. I don't want to get in trouble. You know, those kinds of things. And we move through stages. And really, for a typical adult, that kind of formation, that can go on into our 40s and 50s in terms of really reaching the highest levels where we're able to think about the minority positions of people that are different from our own and have some empathy and connection for the fact that other people haven't had our own set of experiences. or a fully formed conscience, where we are taking responsibility for how we do what we do, because we have our own code of what we think is right. So when you put together the relative youth of the civic life here and the organizations that are in it, and combine that with the relative youth of some of the people in the leadership positions, I think it's contributed to some of the issues that we've seen that have emerged in the workforce that make it potentially feel like a crisis. But as I said, I'd like to think of it more positively as an awakening, an appreciation.
And Leslie, you are a Silicon Valley resident, Silicon Valley historian. Do you agree with them that we're about 40 years mature and still have a lot more maturing to go? And this conversation about diversity and morals and ethics, or lack thereof, here in Silicon Valley is really not a new conversation. It's almost a continuing conversation.
Yeah, I have a lot of things to say about this. I just realized listening to Anne. So I'm afraid I have been studying prenatal Silicon Valley, if we start in 1970s. But I think the overall notion that as an economy we're still growing and learning is absolutely true. I think there are a few things that I would want to point out. One is that when we look at pictures of Silicon Valley in the past, you know, people in the valley, because I really write about people and think about the people, it's easy to look at that and say, oh, okay, so they have mutton chops, or, you know, they have ties that are this wide, or whatever the case may be, but, you know, they all look the same. They're all men, they're all white, they're all, and I have a couple things to say about that. I mean, first of all, the valley's DNA has had a huge immigrant influence from the very, very beginning. If you look at the famous Fairchild Eight, who were the people, the eight men who left working for William Shockley to start the first successful silicon company in Silicon Valley. Two of those eight were immigrants born, you know, outside the United States. Even by the time you're at the 1970s, the valley's running at twice the percent of the population that is immigrant than the rest of the country. And that particular feature has been really important here in the valley, which is this notion of a continual refresh of the best and brightest from around the world. So I want to point that out. I also want to point out that when we see those pictures, what it's hard to remember is that you are looking at a group of outsiders, especially if you look at them once they've become very successful. It's hard to think of them that way. But to take those Fairchild guys again, I mean, these were upstarts. I mean, one of them was over 30 who decided, you know what, working for a Nobel Prize winner is just not doing it for me. These were PhDs. I mean, they had, that was a very difficult thing to do. If you look at the time period that my book is about, if you look at the guys from Atari, now those guys look like outsiders, right? They're having, they are completely redefining how we interact with our televisions. I mean, before these video games really made an appearance, the way that people saw their televisions was only that they brought in broadcast material, and the notion that there could be something interactive, even if it's as stupid as you turn a knob and this thing goes up and down, completely changed how people understood things. And the Apple founders, I mean, one of their funders said they looked like renegades from the human race, you know. And you just kind of keep going up and up and up, and you find that the people who are making a difference here are people who the rest of the world sees as outsiders. And I think it does take that slightly skewed perspective sometimes. We've all had that experience of going to someplace else, and then you realize something about it that the people who live there don't. And I think that's a very important thing for us to remember, that this is a place built by outsiders. And the last thing I would say is the valley has been under fire, and the predictions of its demise, with Mark Twain, right, the rumors of my demise have been greatly exaggerated, or whatever he said, forever. I mean, literally, you can go back to the 70s and find things saying the valley's on its last legs. I mean, it's always been too crowded, it's always been too expensive, it's always been polluted. This has been a big issue. But the oil crisis, you know, the oil shocks in the 70s were going to kill the valley. The competition from the Japanese microchip companies was going to kill the valley. Y2K was going to kill the valley. The dot-com bust was going to kill the valley. China and India were going to kill the valley. And every time the valley comes back, I think what's different now is that the valley and its products are so important to the entire world. We are so embedded in people's lives. And when you think about the panic that you feel when you can't find your cell phone, and people are realizing, oh my God, who are these companies? What are they? They know everything about me. You know, they know where I am. They know who I'm talking to. They're huge. I don't know what they know about me exactly, but it's frightening. And this question of, well, who are these people, and are they like everyone else? I think this is a new question that we're going to need to face. We've never played on this scale before, and the Valley has always been magnificent at making it up as we go along. I mean, in the front of my book, one of the quotes I have is from Indiana Jones, you know, Raiders of the Lost Ark. And I think that it's time now, when we make things up as we go along, to be folding in the perspectives of the rest of the world as a definition for our leadership and our decisions, because what we're doing here is having that kind of impact.
So when it comes to immigration and in the immigrants here in Silicon Valley, you find that we are incredibly diverse. In fact, that is really at our foundation, is outsiders coming in and really building something. But how do we expand that and to get Silicon Valley to see that it's not just about immigrants, it's about other people in our community that are, in a sense, seemingly excluded and needing and could add value here in Silicon Valley, whether it's women or people of other diversities, just here in America.
Yep.
Do you want to?
I'm happy to comment. One of the things that's true, just to reinforce what Leslie said and pick up Kim's question, Santa Clara County was the first plurality in the United States. It was the first place where there was a majority-minority population, and I think it was in April of 98, I want to say, 1998, late 1990s. So that's been part of the story, I agree, all along, as well as sort of the notion of innovation. And perhaps that's allowed us, you know, we really like ourselves here in Silicon Valley. We like our region. We think we're pretty unique. And that's great, and to have that kind of pride in where you're from, but perhaps it's allowed us to take some things for granted and to assume that because we're in a community that has a lot of diversity, that we're actually leveraging that as much as we can. And I think we're seeing now quite clearly evidence that we're not actually engaging as much of the community as we can. And we know, most of us who have been in business settings, in any team setting, actually, that a more diverse perspective, a more diverse group of people coming to work on something and make a set of decisions is going to come to a better outcome. So the quote-unquote business case for diversity, I think, is largely accepted for the most part. Although I know recently and over the summer, there was at least one engineer at one company who had a different perspective, but I think for the most part, it is broadly accepted in Silicon Valley that it's a strength. It's an attribute that we should be striving for. So then you have to ask what makes it so difficult. And then I go back to some of the things that I mentioned, but also the way that corporate culture is sort of allowed to take root here in the Valley. So some companies are very intentional about it. Jeff Weiner, who's CEO of LinkedIn, goes on the record regularly saying, if anybody had ever said to me that the most valuable time I spent as a CEO was on the mission statement and the value statement of LinkedIn in the early days, I would have laughed and rolled my eyes just like everybody else who was in the process. We did those things because we thought we needed to do them, and yet we have returned to them. So there's a company that uses their mission, their vision, their values, and manages their culture, you know, sort of accept some responsibility for what is the experience that people are having when they work here, and feels that it's a critical part of LinkedIn's success. And so I think when you see that, a lot of companies, particularly in the go-go startup mentality that the Valley can, you know, foster, they'll say, well, I don't have time to think about that. You know, that's, I gotta get product out the door. I gotta get my first, you know, shipment, and we can't slow down to think about things like ethics or values. Like, that's just, we can't do that. And yet the companies that have done those things, they last longer, and they have a cohesiveness. They've invested up front in creating some sense of community and commitment, and then they proactively manage that culture over time in a way that I think is more inviting. So you can walk into some companies. I do, we visit a lot of companies at the Markless Center for Applied Ethics. You know, I walked into Uber in 3 years ago and came back to the center and said, that place is a train wreck. And it was a lot of little things. It was not any one thing you would put to, and nothing horrible. It wasn't anything egregious. It was just, as we were being introduced to the company, they spent a lot of time having us sample all their flavored waters and their coffee kegs and their sort of all the superficial things, the perks in the organization. And they were very taken with their own conference room and making the walls opaque, and why do you need to make the walls opaque? And, you know, then when they brought employees into the conversation who had this richness to contribute, they were never invited to contribute. There's a couple of young data analysts who sat through the entire meeting I was in, and afterwards I went up to them and I'm like, hey, what do you guys do? And they had so much to bring to the conversation, but they were never brought into the conversation while we were there. And it was very evident in those, in that time period 3 years ago, before the Uber had come become more transparent about the fact that they were ultimately looking at other technologies down the road than just replacing taxis and transportation modes. And they were very sort of secretive and clandestine about that in kind of an odd way. So. And I should point out the two people that they had come in that had all this richness of information and were not included in the conversation happened to be younger women. Now, is that because they were women that they weren't included? Was it their standing? I have no idea. But why have them in the room ready to present with all this stuff to share? In this case, we were hosting the governor from Delaware and then, you know, never invite them into it. So it was like a lot of little subtle things that... no one thing I would have pointed to and said that you could say there was an issue there, but just in general, emphasis on very superficial things and not really evidence of solid relationships within the workforce with one another.
Where does that come from, Leslie?
Can I ask you a question?
No, definitely.
There are a couple things that are really interesting to me about that. So one is talking about LinkedIn, which makes me think about networks. And I think that with people and with places, kind of the greatest strength is the biggest problem. So, I mean, what has made the Valley remarkable over time are these networks that transcend generations. They used to cross companies and industries. I mean, I personally started wondering if the whole move to we're bringing lunches on site, we're bringing, you know, you basically never have to leave your campus in order to live your life. I don't know what that's going to do to Valley culture, just as a little aside, because it used to be that people would mix all the time at lunches and parties, and there's much less of that happening now, which I think is kind of interesting. But so the great strength of the Valley has been these networks, but then there's the whole question of, well, who's not in the network? And how do you see beyond? I mean, you hear this question on a macro scale about bubbles, you know, how do you see outside the bubble? But for our own sort of personal networks, how do we get beyond what is most easily around us?
And it almost seems like there's something that needs to happen before inception, because it just becomes incestuous. You know, is everyone kind of mixes with the same people and starts a company with the same people and the same investors are on your board and that kind of thing.
That's not a small point. So I mean, the investors being on your board,
right,
has been a long held accepted practice, seen as a good thing for the investors to have a stake and to be representing both present and future shareholder value. But in effect, they actually have their own conflict of interest. They have some very clear financial goals and that they need to meet, and obligations that they have to the people that have invested in their fund that they need to take quite seriously. And I think Uber and others perhaps provide some evidence that other things then get sort of brushed over and not engaged in because we're in the interest of the pursuit of the almighty dollar. I was at the Fortune CEO Initiative in New York in September, and Arianna Huffington was on the panel, and she must just go from conference to panel to panel. I mean, I don't know when that woman sleeps, but she said, and I hope she's right, she said, you know, the days of the brilliant jerk are over. And let's hope that that's true, but for many, many years, the brilliant jerks have been tolerated because they're bringing business returns. And investors are looking at those business returns and saying, I don't want to disrupt that. I need that to continue because I've made these commitments and people have placed their money and their trust in me, and I need that to go forward. So to Leslie's point about networks, sometimes the thing that is a great strength can become your greatest weakness if you don't maintain one of the other strengths of the valley, which is a sense of openness, and now perhaps those networks feel more closed. And so we're delighted, because guess who's here? Tony, join us. Traffic. We can talk about traffic now. I'm sorry.
It may not be more diverse, but it's actually, there are a lot more people here. Thank you so much for being here. Big round of applause. We're very, very thankful. If you wanted to continue, we were talking about networks and the fact that it's really just, it can be seen as being very incestuous here in Silicon Valley. And I don't know if it's on purpose or simply by convenience. What are you thinking?
Well, I think initially it's by convenience. And then, as I say, I think people tend to lose some intentionality around it. I mean, networks have to be managed too. You have to be mindful of not having that sense of insiders and outsiders and the conflicts of interest. You know, you're just sort of recycling the same people. And we've seen some behavior in the Valley that I think just represents the fact that people tend to forget, for example, how comfortable they have become. A few years ago, some of the larger companies, Apple, Google, I can't remember all that were caught up in it, but they had made some kind of informal deal about the fact that they weren't gonna poach each other's employees, which I'm sure to them felt like, hey, you know, this is a tough time and talent is tight and let's all, you know, let's be good to each other and isn't that the way we do it? And yet that fundamentally is collusion, and it sort of separates and ignores employees' rights, and it's, you know, it costs them significantly in terms of fines and I think and reputation. And as I said, I don't think any one of those individuals woke up saying, and today, I'm going to go collude. I think what happens is they become comfortable with one another and a certain way of doing things, and they're always talking to each other. So, and it's a smaller and smaller group where it can become that. And so that's another argument for diversity on boards of all kinds, not just some of the more traditional kinds that we're talking about, although those are very important, gender and ethnicity, but also diversity of background, you know, people that have come up through the ranks versus people that have always been in the C-suite office, people that come from outside the industry that might have other perspectives. I think those are important too, and I think people are starting to appreciate that importance.
Now, you know, obviously there is this really big awareness out there that this is in fact happening. But Nick, there is this big concern that all of this, you know, loudness about diversity and gender equality, that it could actually backfire. I've actually read a number of complaints just in the past few days on Reddit, on Twitter, even on some video game forums as well. Yes, I read those. That it could create greater animosity and separatism and further alienation in, you know, in the way that some of the groups are going about this. Do you agree that we're taking the right approach, or do you think that this approach has to happen in order for the awareness to happen in order for kind of to go in the right direction towards a solution?
Well, I guess I'll say two things. The, I think that, if people have an innate advantage, whatever, however they might have gotten it, they're going to be a little threatened when those advantages go away. And I think, I do see what you're talking about, maybe not on video game forums, but I do see in other places that people, there is sort of a backlash to this kind of extreme intensity that we've got lately. And I think it's great. I mean, I think that this needed to happen, that like for the last 10 years, as a black person in technology, I won't say that I wasn't in Silicon Valley, but like this issue is pervasive. That people have been raising awareness about this forever. And it's finally gotten to the point where it's not just about awareness, people are nodding their heads and agreeing. So although that may be offensive, I wouldn't say that that's off-putting. I think it's actually highlighting the people that we need to get out of this industry. So if you're sitting in your office listening to this conversation and going, wow, like I really don't want those people talking about equality and diversity, none of that's going to happen around here. You probably should get your ass out of this industry. Like that's my honest take on it. So so I would say no. I think the approach for people who are trying to get equality, sometimes you just have to be loud, and that's fine. But I do think that now that we have this awareness, maybe we can shift to a mode where people are actually doing things. That would be nice as well. So at Reddit, we support lots of different things. Like I love people who are out there raising awareness, but I've kind of mentally shifted more over to like if you care about this issue in your position of power, specifically if you can hire people, or you control the culture of your company. Rather than continuing to do the things like around raising awareness, like having classes about diversity and inclusion or unconscious bias, one that like has been pretty popular for the last couple of years, maybe it's instead of doing that or in addition to that, like what I'm doing is just go and hire people. So I'm going to boot camps. I think like the fundamental thing that I would love people to do is like now that awareness has been achieved, that they change their actions and they actually do things to specifically like address pipeline issues, for example. Like one big and very amazing thing that I learned since I moved to Silicon Valley, I'm kind of surprised too. I moved to Silicon Valley and I learned about boot camps. I was incredibly skeptical about boot camps when I was in Seattle. We only hired from like top tier companies and so forth. We had a lot of that meritocratic mentality. And I moved down here and there's like 100 boot camps. And the first one I worked with was this group called HackRight. It's like young women trying to break into technology. And good Lord, I was impressed. Like first time I met them, it made me really rethink the necessity for your like 4-year computer science degree. That maybe like just hustle and urgency and the drive to want to break into this industry may actually be more valuable than like a discrete math. Actually, no, I'll just explicitly say, like, discrete math classes in college are pretty useless. I personally, like, have rethought, like, what it means to get into this industry and the barriers for entry. So, anyway, to answer your question, I think, I applaud people who are making folks uncomfortable, because sometimes you need to be uncomfortable to change. And then, more than that, like, if you're in a position of power, let's actually do something about it. Change the way you hire, like, go and try and change your ratios.
So you're saying for some of those folks that are experiencing the backlash within the organization, just tell those people to get back.
Sorry. It's like, this is not the time to raise your head and fight the trend. This is a good trend.
Is there a way you can balance it, though, so that you don't experience the backlash? Maybe by showcasing the strengths that everyone brings to the table and focusing more on that and making that your priority versus different flavors of water?
I'm actually a big proponent, and it sounds like you might be as well, of really fundamental tools. The one I had good experience with is something I didn't ever think of at the time as being sports related, but it's referred to as the Rooney Rule, and it's named for Dan Rooney, who was the owner of the Steelers, who just passed away recently, because he went to change the NFL had a similar issue with the coaching staff, and really no one in a minority background in a role, and he said, well, from now on, every time we come to interview coaching people for the head coach job, there will be a minority candidate in the finalist pool. And so it became known as the Rooney Rule, and it did ultimately change the makeup of NFL coaches. Years ago, when I worked at the Mercury News in the early 90s, Jerry Sepos and David Yarnold, the executive editor of the Mercury News, instituted what he did not refer to as the Rooney Rule, because journalists probably would not have reacted well to that. But it was the same concept. From now on, because we are this incredibly diverse county, then we're heading to be this first plurality in every single pool of candidates for every position, whether it's a reporting position, an editing position, a photographer. We are going to have a variety of diversity represented in the finalist pool. And while they were waiting for that to happen, to change the profile of the newsroom, which it has dramatically. So now if you pick up the Mercury News, if anybody ever still does pick up the Mercury News in its printed form and look at the bylines, they do reflect the community that we are in, and they have for many years, and the reporting in the Mercury News is stronger for it, and people were able to see that. But it takes time, I think, to your question, to get to being able to see that. And so in the meantime, they did some other very artificial things. There was not a single woman on the group of editors that made the decision about what went on the front page. So what do you think went on the front page every day? Sports and business, every day. And that's fine, that's a big part of community life, but it didn't work for everybody. So they just started rotating at least one woman into the mix of editors that made the decision about what went on the front page, which allowed another voice to be able to say, actually, this is a big story for a certain part of our population, and it should be on the front page. So I think it's the intentionality, it's just being a leader. It's just putting a stake in the ground and saying, we're going to do these things, and we're going to be comfortable doing them because we're actually responsible for the change that needs to happen and accepting that responsibility. There's a fairly strong, and I mean this with a little L, not a political statement, but a libertarian streak in the Valley that sort of says what is, we're, just to continue on with sort of the media analogy, we're not media companies, we're platform companies. We don't really... However people use our platforms and post things and whatever they do, we're not really responsible for that. We're just here to provide the technological platform. And in reality, if you want to grow and sustain an organization, you will have to take responsibility for what people are doing with your products. I mean, that sort of can be akin to the gun companies saying, well, we just make the guns, but people shoot them. I think we're seeing, that's why I refer to it as more of an awakening than a crisis, is that I do think people are understanding that. Oh, we are creating some technologies, they are being used in ways, we do have some practices in our business that are exclusive and leaving out whole populations, and we must change these things. And they're taking a look at them, and we're having the dialogue, and I think that's conversations like this are a critical part of it.
And I think that the media, it has a big responsibility there, and even Reddit as a platform still has a responsibility to bring some other voices to the top, because sometimes the loudest voices are not necessarily the most representative voices, right? You probably find that all the time. I have an interesting point, though, to make that I do think it's also a responsibility of each person in a community that finds it's not being represented to make sure that their voice is heard and put themselves out there. On my radio show, I had a one-hour show where I would interview both men and women, and I will tell you, literally in the past year, 9 out of the last 10 people that I've asked to be on my show were women. 9 out of 10 actually canceled on me. Not just canceled on me, but canceled last minute because other priorities came up. And I would say literally maybe in the past year, 2 men have canceled on me, but immediately they rescheduled. And so I found that to be a problem, I don't know where that problem actually lies in terms of responsibility for ourselves, that we as women in this community do need to put ourselves out there, and we need to take it as a priority, don't you agree? To actually put yourself out there, commit to it, and be the leader and lead by example.
I have something to throw in, too. I mean, we're talking a lot about leadership, and I'm curious if anyone has ever seen the TED Talk about the first follower. Okay, one person. This is worth thinking about. Two, okay, a few people. Because we always talk about the leader, but a lot of people, most people are not the leaders, right? There's one person in the organization that's kind of the leader. This is a video that is actually quite worth watching. It's 3 minutes long. It has a guy, all it is someone, he's dancing without his shirt on, truly in an insane manner, on this bluff. And the person who's giving the TED talk points out, okay, look what happens. One guy comes and joins him. And that guy actually has a shirt, but I don't know that makes a difference. And the first shirtless guy welcomes him in, and then they really start moving along together. And the TED Talk guy says, do you see what's happening here? The lone nut, now that he has a follower, has become a leader. That what makes you a leader is actually followers. And that he further goes on to show that once this next guy starts dancing, all these people start slowly joining until by the end there are, they're literally like shoving aside whoever's taking the videos so they can all join and dance. And the point is that the person that they are following is actually the first follower because they have learned how to follow the leader from the first follower. And I think that's something really important. And of course we all, whatever we look like or wherever we come from, of course we all need to be advocates for ourselves, and obviously, no one cares as much about our careers as we do, and that's all completely true. And of course our leaders need to be setting things up right, but I think we all have that opportunity to be the first follower. And when you see something that needs to change, or you see someone trying to make a difference, don't leave them out there to be the shirtless crazy guy, I mean, join in. And if you are someone who is the shirtless crazy guy, when someone wants to help, that's also your opportunity, because what made that work was that the shirtless guy welcomed the first guy and they started dancing together. And I think that it's really important for all of us to have that sense of responsibility to not only for ourselves, but when you see something, be the first follower, because that's what makes a movement.
So what inspiration can we take from some of the early leaders here in Silicon Valley in terms of creating a stronger, more diverse workforce?
Yeah, well, so
and a supportive environment of that.
I think that there are a lot of people that we could point to. My favorite first follower actually is Mike Markola, who saw two crazy shirtless guys, mainly Jobs and Wozniak, in the garage, and decided to follow them, and did actually make a real move towards a culture that was not that was very systematic focused. That company ended up growing way too fast, etc. We all know that Apple ended up 90 days away from bankruptcy at some point, but nonetheless, that was a deliberate effort to build a culture that was methodical, reasonable. You've seen, actually, I'd say going a little bit earlier than what I'm talking about, when you look at the birth of, Hewlett-Packard is a great example of a company very early on was pursuing actually women in their leadership roles. It was very difficult. There was not the opportunity that there is now, but it's been here for a long time trying to figure out not necessarily out of the sense of this is the right thing to do, this is the ethical thing to do, but simply we need good people, and why on earth would you keep, say, 50% of your population or any portion of the population out of the pool when you're trying to get the very best people?
I just want to point out, though, about HP, because I think it's a good example. There is a company that really invested in how they did things. And so they had a well-known, well-used HP way that was actually a kind of a framework for ethical decision making. Just to pick up what it is Mike Markola has done with his investment in Apple. So that's why our Ethics Center exists. And so organizations can take something like the HP way, or they can take a mission statement or a set of values, and they can turn those into questions that help people to understand what do we think of as the right thing to do in our organization. But they have to get used. And so I think that's one of the things that the HP leadership team did, which therefore it is one of, it would actually be great to get the numbers on how many female executives come from HP. that are now out in the valley in other places, and I bet it's phenomenal. And I think it has as much to do with how committed they were to how they did things and not just what they were doing.
Where did that come from?
Well, it did come from, you know, Bill and Dave. It did come from the original leaders, and they had to have some early followers and some people who really acknowledged and could see what they were doing. And I think I haven't done this, but if I took, we have a model, a practice, if you will, of ethical leadership, things that leaders can do, creating community, encouraging ethical conduct, being very disciplined in their role to avoid those conflicts, clarifying culture when things go wrong, looking at the whole ecosystem, what are we motivating people to do, incentivizing people to do. I have a feeling that they were pretty strong in those areas, and they actually did those things, and they talked about them, and they walked around and shared them with their employees, and they had that sense of community.
It's interesting that you do have very successful companies such as HP, and how they've been able to create a diverse workforce. And then you have places like Salesforce that have done the same, but then how is it that some of these other companies just don't follow suit? How is that possible that so many of the new venture-backed companies are not following in the lines of some very successful leaders in our community, from Mark Benioff to Dave?
These are smaller companies, right? So they're trying to survive. I've actually given talks about this. It's like when you're a really small company, sometimes you're trying to figure out how to get that one customer to pay you, and trying to simultaneously figure out how to build a diverse workforce, which is very difficult in the valley for lots of different reasons, comes second or third place to just getting your next customer. So I think that there's an unfortunate reality that like business priorities versus focusing on diversity can sometimes come into conflict at the very early stage. But the thing that like we're trying to do at Reddit, and we're very clear in the exec team, we got to a certain size where we felt safe. Like we knew we could expend effort to put the time and effort it would take to build a diverse company up front, because it's much, much harder to fix it later. HP, and I was at Microsoft, when you have like billions of dollars in the bank, you can invest in all sorts of different programs, leadership training, to try and improve diversity. You don't have access to those things if your company is only like 50 people. But when your company is only 50 people and you're expanding, you also have the opportunity to like solve it right then. And that's the approach that we're trying to take at Reddit. It's in that very early phase, sometimes it's just get the one next customer, but if you have ethical leaders, at some point you'll realize like, hey, we're safe, let's do the right thing. And then as we expand, we'll take that as part of our DNA as we grow.
I have a question for you about Reddit. So it's a company I only know from the outside, but a couple years ago, right, it was known for some of its board, yeah. You said it.
I said crazy shit. That was what.
Yeah. And so I'm curious to know, has the sort of inside of Reddit, namely the leadership, changed in an effort or somehow concomitant with the changes you're trying to create on the platform? I mean, can you talk a little bit about that? And especially, I mean, that is a very dramatic change with a real risk of alienating, like, your core business.
Controls.
Yeah.
So I'd love to hear what you think, because I'm curious to know.
I'm about to take a long time. Is that okay? So Reddit today, and I joined like a year and a month ago. Steve and the founders joined like about 2.5 years ago. And then I would describe like 3 years ago as like a rolling train wreck. Like I think that's the easiest way to describe it. Like toxic culture, the site itself was kind of being run amok by, I guess, some of these troll communities. And a lot of things have changed since then. It's a very, very different company internally. And the reason for that is like we want to have the company's internal values fixed before we go and start to make broader changes in this like 100 million user. So internally, the long story short of it is we replaced the executive leadership team. I was one of the last execs to join. I'll just be blunt, like most of the employees who were here at Reddit 3 years ago are no longer with the company. and we tried to bring in people who wanted Reddit to be more welcoming, essentially. It was a point in the history where people wanted Reddit to just be its own insular community, stay the way it was. And that's why it didn't change for so long. That's why it kind of attracted and created a certain type of audience. But the executive team now wants Reddit to be available to the world. Like, we really think that everyone should be able to find a home in a community around whatever passions or interests that they have, and that Reddit should be the platform where that can take place. But that can't happen if every time you try and log into the site, you like see an ugly website, or you're immediately greeted by one of these trolls. So we've done a lot of things internally first, you know, hiring people who agree with that vision about making the product more welcoming. And then two, we built what's called an anti-evil or trust and safety team. It's one of the fastest growing parts of the company. And these guys basically try and act as a policing force for our rules on the community. And the final thing is we've started like explicitly and more intentionally enforcing the rules. And we couldn't do that as easily before because both internally and externally, there wasn't really alignment that these rules mattered. And now we've kind of turned the corner on that. Like, so when we shut down a community that's violating the rules, we no longer get the community backlash. We actually turned one off yesterday that I was really happy about. It was this I won't even go into it. It was this community that was really unfriendly to women. It was called incels. It was like disgusting. And we shut that down, and we got kind of applauded by the community, which is something that wouldn't have happened like 3 years ago. So I think that, 300 million monthly active users is a lot of momentum to me, but I think that if you ignore kind of these loudest troll users and look at the community as a whole, mm-hmm. I think the community as a whole is good. And we want to make it so that their voices are heard, even when they don't have the power to fight against these trolls, we're trying to help them. And if we continue acting in the way that we're currently acting, enforcing the rules, continuing to invest in this anti-evil team, continuing to shut down communities that make the site less welcoming to net new users, we're going to end up in a really good place.
I love, Nick, that Reddit is such a great example of this baseball analogy that a friend of mine, Mark Goldstein, who used to be the fund manager for Mark Benioff at Salesforce, he said that, you know, you never, that's why with baseball, that you have the closers. You never close with the same team you start with. And I think that that's a great example of a very successful business, is to not be afraid to make those changes as you grow. I want to open it up to questions out in the audience. Do you have any questions for Leslie, Nick, or Anne?
Oh, come on, y'all, don't be shy.
Right here.
I'll ask a question. Hi, I'm Mary Kay.
Thank you.
Good morning. I'm Mary Kay from Solemn Consulting, and I was just wondering about the Reddit story, Nick. Was there an incident 3 years ago that was a turning point? And can you talk about that incident, or was it just an awakening from the leadership that important?
There was a very specific incident. The former CEO of Reddit was a very smart woman. Her name's Ellen Powell. Probably you guys have heard her. And she effectively was trying to do all the things I'm describing. I think that she maybe tried to move too quickly. But she basically came up with a set of rules that she wanted to enforce, community guidelines for the community, and she rolled them out very quickly and shut down several communities. But the community wasn't ready for that level of change. It couldn't absorb it. And unfortunately, like the way Reddit, well, I won't say unfortunately, like the way Reddit works is we're a collection of communities, and some of our biggest communities are driving most of the traffic to the site. So like r/politics or r/AMA, like those are people who are volunteers, like just running these gigantic million user forums, like on like because they like to do it. So we had this rules enforcement come in. We shut down a few communities that didn't meet the rules. And then these moderators, these folks who run communities, kind of revolted and said, hey, like, we're doing this because we love it, and you're just trying to come in with this whole new sweeping set of changes. And they actually turned the entire site, like, when I say turn the site off, you can set your community private mode. So imagine, like, one day this community is getting millions and millions and millions of page views from people all over the world, and the next day you go there and it's just, like, blank, shut down. And they did that across like all the major communities in protest of these changes. And that led to a lot of different changes at the company. I would say that was the moment that, that was certainly the moment we realized we had a problem. Also, Ellen ended up leaving shortly thereafter, and then eventually Steve and Alexis came back. And I think that the difference with what we have now is that we're trying to take a more, we're trying to work more hand in hand with the moderators to make these changes, rather than just drop it on them all at once. So it's taken a little bit longer, but I think the results are we haven't had any like blackouts in a long time. And we're starting to get to a world where we can just shut down communities that are breaking the rules without getting any community backlash, really. We haven't really had that problem in a long time.
It's really about designing something for where people are, understanding where they are, and then guiding them where you want them to be.
Yeah, I mean, I think the intent of those new rules was completely spot on. But, I mean, sometimes you can want, you want the change so badly you don't think about the road that it's going to take.
So what I hear in that is some of those elements, those practices, if you will, investing the time in the mission, the value, and making the decisions. There's going to be new rules and having rules that I don't hear in some of the other other companies that are grappling right now with how their technology is being used. Still seem to be unwilling to own some of that decision making, to set some rules, and to be willing to lose some business in the short term to preserve what they were originally trying to create in the longer term. So there's some great real examples in there of that creating community, of that sort of the clarifying culture piece once you've had things that have gone wrong, kind of resetting and making those statements about it. And at the Markle Center, we try still to engage the companies while they're still trying to get their first customer. We have an ethical culture assessment tool and have started trying to get the VC companies, because the portfolio companies are in this sort of mode of must get out the door, to get the backers, the investors, to encourage the companies to take advantage of some of the tools that exist that would allow them to have some of that that dialogue and that community creation up front. And then we do a lot of things like this as well. So our theme this year happens to be diversity in the workplace. And so the Markle Center, we kick off next week, and our first one's looking at speech, microaggressions, freedom of speech in the workplace. And all those are also open to the public, to Silicon Valley professionals, and free of charge. So trying to get people to consider all the ways that you can bring change to bear on a community, but not giving up on the early stage companies, because I still think that's where a lot of culture formation happens.
I think there's, like, on early stage, I think I'm such a strong believer in boot camps now. Like, I feel like...
I'm getting that sense.
I would not have said the same thing like a year ago. I don't know. You come down here, I think that at Reddit, a lot of the engineering managers that we brought in and a significant portion of like the architects and really high performers of the team have come from boot camps. I can't explain it. Like a person who used to be doing, ethnographic studies is now like the best engineering manager I have on my team after about 2 or 3 years of training. It's really caused me to rethink like our pipeline and so forth.
Next question.
Anne, I wanted to pick up on your comment about having the Rooney Rule and a diverse pool of candidates. Another action that works really well is to have a diverse interview panel. So if you're trying to attract a diverse set of employees, it really helps for them to see people like them in the interview panel as well. So encourage everyone to take that action.
Just to add on to that, like when we talk about diverse interview panel, one thing that we do at Reddit is we also, for engineering roles, we include non-engineering people on the interview panel. So we'll have folks from like finance or sales come in as well to try and make sure that there's going to be, I hate to use the word culture fit, but I don't have a better way to describe it. We just want to make sure that these people are going to be enjoyable to work with, not just with engineers, but the entire company.
Hi, I'm Rose. I executive search, an international search consultant. And Nika, what you said, you know, when you're a small company and you're trying to be successful, it's hard to be diverse, because I know I work with a lot of European and Asian companies coming to the United States, and talk about ethics. You know, they only want the white, male, certain age, da-da-da-da-da. And even the, you know, the boards, you know, and the VCs, oh, they recommend people that look like them. So it's hard for these small companies to really be diverse, because that's not the first thing on their mind. The first thing on their mind is to become successful.
Right, there's even, I mean, you have so many different, whether it's race or religion or sex or gender or whatever it is, you have age discrimination, and, you know, it just goes on and on and on. It's just all about creating a diverse workforce and looking for the people who have the strongest skill sets to do the job, and looking beyond all of that, don't you think?
Yeah, I mean, I don't think there's an easy solution to that. I do think that over time, I can't speak to the people you're working with from China and so forth. Maybe we'll solve that in 2030, 2040. Or maybe not at all. But I think that in Silicon Valley, if I'm trying to do a startup here, like, the reality is that the talent pool is not such that it's easy for me to go and have access to a lot of diverse talent. Like, even if I want it, it's just hard to find. So when people I don't like when people complain about the pipeline problem and just say, oh, I can't solve it. But there is a problem with access to talent. But I think nowadays, at least my impression is that, like, things are starting to change. Like, I don't want to go back to boot camps. I'll simply say that, like, rather
there
than...
are these special places.
Yeah, it's like,
that's a great example. Like, well, the company changes where they're willing to start sourcing from.
Yeah.
And it's not just the, you know, a certain type of profile from a certain type of school.
That's the thing.
That's,
it's like,
that's
what's changing.
I love the boot camps.
Yeah. It's like the attitude around, like, to only hire, like, if you're trying to build a diverse pipeline, but then you know that there's a pipeline problem coming from, from Silicon Valley, you can't find folks. You also have that same problem at, like, at colleges, right? Yeah. I'm only going to hire at, like, top 10, like Ivy League college. Well, they have that problem too. So, like, you're building, like, problems on top of problems. And, like, you have to change your mindset about how you're going to source talent before you can really solve this problem. And the reason I keep harping on boot camps is because it changed my mind. Like, a year ago, I would have told you, you're insane. Don't staff your, like, startup team with boot camps. And now I'm telling you, like, this is great. This is, like, frankly, like, affordable talent that is going to work, like, really, really hard. And you can get good results. And you can probably get, like, a diverse workforce right off the bat. Like, I do think that there's, like, some things have changed recently that, like, give me hope. And that's where I'll leave it off.
And to just put in a plug for history here, Steve Jobs didn't graduate college. Mark Zuckerberg didn't graduate college. If you look, I remember having a really long conversation with Andy Grove, where he said, we need to be putting a lot of resources into the junior colleges, because so much of this work doesn't actually require a four-year degree. So there's a long chain behind what you're talking about.
Yeah. JavaScript frameworks change, like, every 6 months. Like, if you tell me you go to college and learn JavaScript, it's like, it's delusional nowadays. I think you actually learn more practical skills in other places. And I hate to go so hard on this, but my mindset really has, like, changed over the last year.
Next question.
Yes, my name is Pernilla Gutierrez-Corbay. I'm a visiting researcher at Stanford University in responsible leadership. And I wanted to build on your question because I hear that there is a lot of awareness and the will to change and to make a difference. But do you see the same will to change among investors and the people who have the money and the VCs?
That's a really good question.
So, We are seeing some change there, and one of those will be announced actually at our Diversity Dialogue series in January, on January 18th. BlackRock, Michelle Edkins will be coming to talk about from the institutional investor perspective, and they've made an early move in climate requirements for companies and sort of saying you must meet certain requirements, and now they're getting ready to make a move on the diversity front too, and I think it's pretty exciting. And so I think there is some movement there, but there needs to be more. Companies really reflect the culture of the board, and in the early stage companies, the board is often investors. And then as companies mature, they'll be dealing more with the likes of a BlackRock in terms of who's holding their shares. And I do think markets are a big driver, and the investment market itself is starting to be responsive, I think, to both what individuals want out of their investments, which is sometimes referred to as impact investing. It has a lot of different names, following ESG measures, environment, social, governance measures, which are new metrics in businesses, and whole new institutions are being created to support those. So any of you familiar with FASB, which is the Financial Accounting Standards Board that accountants follow? Now there's SASB, which is the sustainability standards, which is sort of trying to get at those ESG measures. So I do see, I'm also hopeful, I do see some changes. And I do see, I hear people saying, for example, about the board and investment, you know, we're just going to do some pretty dramatic things. You know, back at the CEO conference in New York, it was, you know, we're just going to start, every person that we put on our board is going to be a woman for a while, and we're still going to get very qualified people because there's plenty of qualified women out there. And the numbers are so low that if we don't do that, we're not going to change things. And when that was said, you know, people applauded and nodded and whatever, and there wasn't any of the pushback that I think I've experienced in the time that I've been in Silicon Valley and in those roles where people would say, oh, but that's not fair, you can't do that. To some degree, people are over fair, and they're really trying to push for that change.
Next question.
Jack Russo from Computer Law Group. So I've been here in the Valley for going on over 40 years, so I've seen a lot of the people. I was at Fenwick & West previously. We started Apple Computer, so we know the whole backstory. But the topic today is raising the bar, raising the leadership bar. And I'm hearing sort of an indirect statement that, well, maybe Silicon Valley will create an innovation to do it. And when you said, I could see the train wreck coming from Uber, the immediate question that came to my mind is if you had a way to post that in a glass door, perhaps it'd be called Glass Valley kind of place, would that guy have been saved by able to read that to say, look, the sense of your culture is you're on a train wreck path?
Or that do you think guy?
That
no.
guy? And more broadly, would leaders, real leaders, pick up and read Glass Valley or Glass House or whatever it's called and say, hey, something is off the rails here. Maybe we have to do a course adjustment.
No, I think it's that the investors are starting to see it where they need to see it to make the change, which is all of a sudden the people that had funded Uber could see that they might potentially never recoup their investment and never be able to get out of the company kind of returns that they needed to, that they had initially thought they would, and they've been able to identify that we have a leadership and culture issue and change it. And I think that's what has to happen for organizations to do that. And we as consumers and investors ourselves, the shares of companies that you hold, whether you know you hold them or not in your IRAs or whatever investment tools you're using, and the technology that you decide to use, that's some of the strongest power we have as individuals to say what we're going to tolerate. And I think, so Snap is another one that I put in the same category as Uber in terms of, and have written about, sort of questionable corporate and leadership reputation. And I say to my daughter, you know, you can use Instagram, you can use it, but you can't have a Snapchat account. and it's one small little move, and maybe it's not going to make a difference. But before they went public, I certainly could point to things in both their ownership structure and in their in the CEO, and suggest that it wasn't a great investment, and I think the market's bearing that out.
So final remarks on really raising the bar. You all believe that this is a mess that can be undone. So give us a few final thoughts on the steps that we can take here in this room to help make this happen. And I know it's going to boot camps. But maybe you can expand on also what that means. And we'll go maybe out of order, but what does it mean to go to boot camps? There are a variety. And I even look at going to boot camps as even Facebook groups that you wouldn't normally join.
No, I mean very specifically, I guess what I'm saying is, like, there's channels to get into the tech industry that as leaders and hiring managers we have to become more accepting of, because if we don't, we're missing out on great talent. Like, that's the simplest way I can put it. And I think that the challenge with boot camps is that they're not all of the same quality. These aren't usually accredited institutions, so if you're a hiring manager, you go take a bet on one of these things, you're kind of putting your own reputation on the line, and there's some risk. But what I've come to understand over the last, like, year is, like, you kind of take similar risk with any new grad you might hire. You never quite know. Like, I've hired people from Harvard, MIT, Princeton, and just, you know, some went well, some went poorly, and I think that with boot camps you can take a similar bet, but what you have is somebody who maybe has a demonstrated track record in another industry and guaranteed hustle as well. And I think I've started to just bet on hustle. The other thing I would say is, this is just kind of a minor nitpick. Like, if anyone in your organization ever says, like, they want to support diversity of thought or something like that instead of actual diversity, like, they're not the person you need running your your program. Like, it's quite, like, offensive to some people. Like, I had someone say to me, they said, I don't see color. I was like, wow, that hurts, because, like, you're discounting, like, my entire life experience. Thank you very much. Like, no, but I meant it in a nice way. I was like, I'm trying to figure out what that means. So I think, like, there's people that I've heard recently, because trying to solve diversity issues is so difficult, have kind of switched into this mode of, like, well, if we can just get people to think diversely, maybe that'll be a good starting point. And I just think that's a really bad idea. I think, like, if you need help finding diverse talent in your organization, just call me. I will, like, point it at you, and then, like, please just interview those people. It's actually not that hard. I think people need to overcome these kind of excuses that they create for themselves. And then the final thing I'd say is, have all of your leaders care about this. Don't just hire, like, a chief diversity officer. That's the other thing. Like, I don't want to call out any specific companies, but, like, I know a lot of chief diversity officers who don't actually have the ability to hire people. And, you need to have your exec team on board if you actually want to change anything. You can't just have someone off to the side who is, like, trying to be the face of diversity, but they can't actually hire anybody. Like, that kind of kills me. And I see it in several different places. So I'll stop ranting.
Right, you need an HR person that will actually, a regular HR person with the power for hiring to actually be someone with a diversity mindset.
I don't mind if companies want to hire one of these folks because they just want to show that they care, because it is a hard problem, right? So you hire someone, chief diversity director, they're like, we care. But then also just make sure that everyone else cares, too. Don't put it all on their one person.
Leslie?
Yeah, I mean, I think the lesson that I've picked up looking over time, and honestly listening today, is how do you hit this balance between having a great culture, or how do you live a great culture? And I think it does just simply have to do with having the people you want in the room. And I that sounds pretty obvious, but I do think that we see time and time again that talk is very, very cheap. And doing this sort of work is actually, it sounds expensive at the beginning, but like everything else in Silicon Valley, it gathers its own momentum. So you get these things started, and you really can take advantage of that.
Yeah. I'll just reinforce, I mean, I hear in both Leslie and Nick's comments, the value of finding and creating common ground using mission, purpose, values, whatever the mechanism can be, so that the entire executive team thinks about things the same way. But really, and this goes to the first follower too, it's use your own power. If you're on the team and the team hasn't invested in articulating how they're going to do things, suggest it. you know, and if you're using technology and you don't really understand how that company is using your own data or information, stop using it until you figure that out. And similarly, you know, down the path with investments and other choices that we make. We have more choice and power, I think, sometimes than we want to acknowledge, and that's the personal leadership piece.
I do have one final thought as well, just kind of summarizing it up. It was a little bit of a personal experience that when Richard Branson's team, including Bill Tye, if you're familiar with Bill Tye, angel investor here in Silicon Valley, when they came to me and asked me to run their global startup competition, I said, oh my God, I have no experience. I'm a journalist. I've never run a global startup competition. I mean, seriously. And they said, don't let what you don't know and have never done before get in the way of your success. And I would adapt that a little bit to what we're talking about. Don't let what someone else doesn't know or has never done before get in the way of allowing them to make a difference within your organization, no matter who they are. Let's have a big round of applause.
Thank you very, very much for sharing your perspective so candidly. Let's give them another round of applause. Small token of our appreciation for you coming out this morning. It is the Churchill Club speaker t-shirt.
Thank you.
A recording of this program will be available on our YouTube channel, so please check it out and let others know about it. We hope people will find that to be a very useful resource in general. Our next public program is coming up on the 27th of this month, featuring the Porsche AG CEO Oliver Blume, and as well as the Porsche Digital CEO, Tilo Kozlowski. That should be a very interesting program. We have Leslie's book, courtesy of Books, Inc., available for purchase. It is a wonderful read, so if you'd like to pick one up, it's available out in the lobby here. And you've been a very wonderful audience. Thank you so much for coming out, and we'll see you next time.